Hello everyone. I'm Ted. And today we will continue with Chapter 9. Developing Human Resources. And in this chapter we will be discussing Management Development, Introduction, Definition and Importance, Developing Human Resources Methods, Apprenticeship, Understudy, Job Rotation, Vestibule Training, Case Study Method, Role Playing, Sensitivity Training, In Basket Exercises, Management Games, Conferences and Seminars, Coaching and Mentoring. Let's start. Introduction. Development is an education process as it tries to enhance one's ability to understand and interpret knowledge in a useful way. Development is different from training in that it is often the result of experience and the maturity that comes with it. It is possible to train most people to drive a vehicle, operate a computer, or assemble a radio. However, development in such areas as judging what is right or wrong, taking responsibility for results, thinking logically, understanding cause and effect relationships, synthesizing experiences to visualize relationships, improving communication skills, etc., may or may not come through over time. Training certainly helps in improving these types of skills. But when the intent is to enhance executives' ability to handle diverse jobs and prepare them for future challenges, the focus must shift to executive development. Executive development focuses more on the manager's personal growth. It is more future-oriented and more concerned with education than is employee training. Moving next. Definition. Executive or management development is a planned, systematic and continuous process of learning and growth by which managers develop their conceptual and analytical abilities to manage. It is the result of not only participation in formal courses of instruction but also of actual job experience. It is primarily concerned with improving the performance of managers by giving them stimulating opportunities for growth and development. Moving next. Importance. Executive development has become indispensable to modern organizations for the following reasons. For any business, executive development is an invaluable investment in the long run. It helps managers to acquire knowledge, skills, and abilities, KSAs, required to grapple with complex changes in environment, technology, and processes quite successfully. They can have a better grip over market forces and get ahead of others in the race in a confident manner. Developmental efforts help executives to realize their own career goals and aspirations in a planned way. Executives can show superior performance on the job. By handling varied jobs of increasing difficulty and scope, they become more useful, versatile, and productive. The rich experience that they gain over a period of time would help them step into the shoes of their superiors easily. Executive development programs help managers to broaden their outlook, look into various problems dispassionately, examine the consequences carefully, appreciate how others would react to a particular solution, and discharge their responsibilities, taking a holistic view of the entire organization. The special courses, projects, committee assignments, job rotation, and other exercises help managers to have a feel of how to discharge their duties without rubbing people, subordinates, peers, superiors, competitors, customers, etc., the wrong way. Moving next. Developing human resources, methods. Apprenticeship training. Most craft workers such as plumbers and carpenters are trained through formal apprenticeship programs. Apprentices are trainees who spend a prescribed amount of time working with an experienced guide, coach, or trainer. Assistantships and internships are similar to apprenticeships because they also demand high levels of participation from the trainee. An internship is a kind of on-the-job training that usually combines job training with classroom instruction in trade schools, colleges, or universities. Industrial training institutes, ITIs, are set up in India for this purpose only. Advantages. Apprentices can earn stipend while they undergo training. It is a kind of earn while you learn scheme. It helps the employer to get employees trained in a proper way from designated industrial training institutes and trade schools. After the training, Employees become skilled craftsmen. They acquire in their career. Training is market relevant and job centric. So employees can move from low-end job to a superior one quite easily. Over a period of time, a firm can create a pool of technically qualified people who remain loyal to the firm for fairly obvious reasons. Disadvantages. It takes a lot of time and effort to train people and make them learn systematically. It is an expensive job since it demands a lot of time from expert trainers who need to invest their time and energies in a patient manner. One important disadvantage of the apprenticeship methods is the uniform period of training offered to trainees. People have different abilities and learn at varied rates. Those who learn fast may quit the program in frustration. Slow learners may need additional training time. It is also likely that in these days of rapid changes in technology, old skills may get outdated quickly. Trainees who spend years learning specific skills may find, upon completion of their programs, that the job skills they acquired are no longer appropriate. Understudy. An understudy is a person who is in training to assume at a future time the full responsibility of the position currently held by his superior. This method supplies the organization a person with as much competence as the superior to fill his post, which may fall vacant because of promotion, retirement, or transfer. An understudy is usually chosen by the head of a particular department. The head will then teach him what all his job involves. The superior involves him in decision-making by discussing the daily operating problems as well. Understudy assignments help the superior to lighten his workload by delegating some portion of his work to a designated person. The understudy, in turn, gets an opportunity to learn the superior's job and get ready for challenging roles at a later date. It is beneficial from the organization's point of view also, as it will not be at the receiving end when an executive suddenly leaves his job. Advantages. It helps the superior to lighten his workload. The trainee can learn a lot by doing everything independently under the guidance of an expert trainer. The trainee gets a chance to look at the job from various perspectives. When vacancies arise, well-trained people are readily available within the firm. Trainees tend to look at this method as a motivational device, since it helps them grow vertically. When a qualified person leaves the firm, another trained subordinate can slip into that role effortlessly. Disadvantages. Designating an understudy indicates an opportunity to get promoted when the vacancy comes. This could become an eyesore for other subordinates who are left out in the race. The one who gets a chance to get trained may take the assignment for granted. The ones who are left out suffer from jealousy and negative feelings for a long time to come. The trainee may not gain much from his superior. Job rotation. This kind of training involves the movement of trainee from one job to another. Job rotation helps a trainee to have a general understanding of how the organization functions. The purpose of job rotation is to provide trainees with a larger organizational perspective and a greater understanding of different functional areas, as well as a better sense of their own career objectives and interests. Apart from relieving boredom, job rotation allows trainees to build rapport with a wide range of individuals within the organization, facilitating future cooperation among departments. The cross-trained personnel offer a great amount of flexibility for organizations when transfers, promotions, or replacements become inevitable. Advantages. Trainee is able to exploit potential. Job-related competencies improve. Trainees can network with colleagues in various departments, and this helps improve interdepartmental coordination. Varied work assignments rekindle interest in trainees. Boredom and monotony arising out of doing the same kind of job over and over can be put to rest. Quick learners can slip into challenging roles that demand the competencies of a generalist in place of a specialist. Fresh ideas and new ways of doing things can emerge as trainees interact and cross-fertilize ideas, opinions, and thoughts with colleagues from various departments actively. Disadvantages. Workload of trainees increases considerably. Constant job change may produce stress and anxiety. Merely multiplication of duties may not enrich the life of a trainee. It may prove to be a costly exercise if trainees commit mistakes and handle tasks less optimally. Trainees may find it difficult to adjust to new bosses and new colleagues. Before the dust settles down, in most cases, they may find themselves in a new department. The morale of trainees may be impacted negatively. The whole exercise of moving people across departments may turn out to be a competitive game of musical chairs. Managers may use this as a whip to see off unwanted people in a department. Job rotation. Job rotation may pose several problems, especially when the trainees are rolled on various jobs at frequent intervals. In such a case, trainees do not usually stay long enough in any single phase of the operation to develop a high degree of expertise. For slow learners, there is little room to integrate resources properly. Trainees can become confused when they are exposed to rotating managers with contrasting styles of operation. Today's manager's commands may be replaced by another set from another manager. Further, job rotation can be quite expensive. A substantial amount of managerial time is lost when trainees change positions because they must get acquainted with different people and techniques in each department. Development costs can go up and productivity is reduced by moving a trainee into a new position when his efficiency levels begin to improve at the prior job. Inexperienced trainees may fail to handle new tasks in an efficient way. Intelligent and aggressive trainees, on the other hand, may find the system to be thoroughly boring as they continue to perform more or less similar jobs without any stretch, pull and challenge. To get the best results out of the system, it should be tailored to the needs, interests, and capabilities of the individual trainee, and not be a standard sequence that all trainees undergo. Job rotation, of course, allows the manager to operate in diverse roles and understand the different issues that crop up. If someone is aspiring to be a corporate leader, then he or she must have this type of training. A recent study indicated that the single most significant factor leading to leaders' achievement was the variety of experiences in different departments, business units, cities, and countries. Vestibule training. It is a kind of classroom training that is imparted by using materials, files, machines, and equipment which are similar to those that are used in the actual workplace. A training center known as a vestibule is set up, which is nothing but a simulated model of the actual work situation so that trainees learn without any disturbance. In this method, actual work conditions are simulated in a classroom. This type of training is commonly used for training personnel for clerical and semi-skilled jobs. The duration of this training ranges from a few days to a few weeks. Theory can be related to practice in this method. Advantages. Trainees receive instructions and training in a separate room without any distractions and interruptions. This facilitates quick learning. Trainees learn correct and appropriate ways of doing things. Trainees can quickly learn by doing things in an environment which is quite similar to what they would be doing in a work spot. Qualified trainers can put trainees on track. The most economical ways of doing things can be taught quickly, eliminating wastages of all kinds. Right from day one, trainees can prove themselves without having to face ridicule or critical remarks from supervisors and colleagues. It is possible to train large number of trainees in duplicated work settings fairly quickly. Disadvantages. It is an expensive method. The organization needs to spend a lot of money in order to create a simulated work spot consisting of materials, machines, equipment, and qualified trainers. The training environment is somewhat artificial. Simulated work settings may not give that feeling having done something that he can be proud of. Supervisors resent and object to this kind of training since they are stripped off the training function and are asked to perform the duties of a policeman. Trainees may still suffer from psychological fear of not having done the actual job in a real work setting. Unless they get a feel of the actual job, such fears cannot be put to rest. Case study method. This is a training method that employs simulated business problems for trainees to solve. The individual is expected to study the information given in the case and make decisions based on the situation. If the student is provided a case involving an actual company, he is expected to research the firm to gain a better appreciation of its financial condition and corporate culture. Typically, the case method is used in the classroom with an instructor who serves as a facilitator. Experienced trainers readily point out that the case study is most appropriate where analytical, problem-solving, and thinking skills are most important. The KSAs are complex and participants need time to master them. Active participation is required. The process of learning, questioning, interpreting, etc., is as important as the content. Team problem-solving and interaction are possible. Merits. It improves problem-solving skills of participants. It is a way of learning by doing. Participants can apply theoretical knowledge to practical problems and learn quickly. Trainees learn how others solve a problem and begin to appreciate each other's thinking. Case studies can provide interesting debates among trainees, as well as excellent opportunities for individuals to defend their analytical and judgmental abilities. If the case reflects a real-life situation, participants take keen interest and examine the cross-currents with an open and inquisitive mind. Demerits. It is a costly and time-consuming method. It takes time to collect data, analyze, summarize and put the case study in place. Examining historical evidence may fail to develop the analytical and reasoning abilities of participants. Cases, sometimes, are not sufficiently realistic to be useful. Cases may contain information appropriate to the kinds of decisions that a mean the cross-currents with an open trainees would make in a real setting. Indiscriminate use of case studies may not help participants who are not mature enough to analyze and participate in discussions actively. A trainee who is not skilled in this technique can undermine its usefulness. Case study method. The success of this method is closely linked to the maturity and experience of the trainer who should facilitate the group's learning. Keep participants on track and help them see the underlying management concepts in the case clearly. Further, it is also necessary to come up with good case material based on real-life situations and present the same before trainees in an interesting manner. When cases are meaningful and are similar to work-related situations, trainees can certainly improve their decision-making skills and problem-solving abilities. Role play. This is a technique in which some problem, real or imaginary, involving human interaction is presented and then spontaneously acted out. Participants may assume the roles of specific organizational members in a given situation and then act out their roles. For example, a trainee might be asked to play the role of a supervisor who is required to discipline an employee smoking in the plant in violation of the rules. Another participant would assume the role of the employee. The individual playing the supervisory role would then proceed to take whatever action he deems appropriate. This action then provides the basis for discussion and comments by the groups. Merits. Role play develops interpersonal skills among participants. They learn by doing things. Immediate feedback helps them correct mistakes, change, switch gears, change hats and reorient their focus in a right way. The competitive atmosphere spurs them to participate actively, listen to what others say, observe, and analyze behavioral responses and improve their own performance by putting their textual learning to test. Demerits. On the negative side, realism is sometimes lacking in role play, so the learning experience is diminished. It is not easy to duplicate the pressures and realities of actual decision-making on the job and individuals. Often act very differently in real-life situations than they do in acting out a simulated exercise. Many trainees are often uncomfortable in role-playing situations, and trainers must introduce the situations well so that learning can take place. To this end, trainers should ensure that members of the group are comfortable with each other. Select and prepare the role players by introducing a specific situation. Help participants prepare. Ask them to prepare potential characters. Realize that volunteers make better role players. Prepare observers by giving them specific tasks, e.g. evaluation, feedback. Guide the role play enactment over its bumps, since it is not scripted. Keep it short. Discuss the enactment and prepare bullet points of what was learned. Sensitivity or T group. This is a method of changing behavior through unstructured group interaction. Sensitivity training is sought to help individuals toward better relations with others. The primary focus is on reducing interpersonal friction. In sensitivity training, the actual technique employed is T-group. T stands for training. It is a small group of 10 to 12 people assisted by a professional behavioral scientist who acts as a catalyst and trainer for the group. There is no specified agenda. He merely creates the opportunity for group members to express their ideas and feelings freely. Since the trainer has no leadership role to play, the group must work out its own methods of proceeding. A leaderless and agenda-free group session is on. They can discuss anything they like. Individuals are allowed to focus on behavior rather than on duties. As members engage in a dialogue, they are encouraged to learn about themselves as they interact with others. Merits. Participants gain confidence and learn how to present themselves before a group. The experience is uniquely beneficial in developing their personality. Healthy interaction allows participants to learn from others. They also learn the ways and means to get along with people. Once they get to know each other better, participants tend to overlook even the blind spots and personality weakness and move ahead. Participants learn unique ways and means to put out fires, resolve things smoothly and put emotional objections to rest. They begin to look at issues from a 360-degree perspective. The overall emotional sensitivity of the group improves. Open communication helps participants to be honest in their interactions. Research on sensitivity training reveals significant changes in attitudes, behavior, and personal growth of participants. Demerits. It may turn out to be a waste of time if dominating individuals take the group for a ride. T-group leaders may bulldoze dissent, block honest opinions, and frustrate TH attempts of those who want to express their views in front of others. The T-group experience is an immoral and unjustified invasion of privacy, based on false assumptions about the nature of human relationship at work. Agenda-less and direction-less discussions may produce anxiety and stress among participants. Participants may lose interest in the proceedings midway. Open sharing of thoughts might go against the personal interests of a trainee, especially when the leaders tend to take it as a personal attack. The process of sensitivity training involves an emotional bloodbath. It can shatter personal defenses and damage future capabilities. Immature trainees and intolerant bosses could spoil the show. Teamwork and team spirit might get impacted negatively. In basket exercises. In this method, the participant is given a number of business papers such as memoranda, reports, and telephone messages that would typically cross a manager's desk. The papers, presented in no particular sequence, call for actions ranging from urgent to routine handling. The participant is required to act on the information contained in these papers. Assigning a priority to each particular matter is initially required. If the trainee is asked to decide issues within a time frame, it creates a healthy competition among participants. Merits. The method is simple and easy to follow. Trainees learn quickly as they have to list priorities, make assumptions, assign work to others, and get things done within a time frame. Since participants hail from various sections, it is easy to put out inter-departmental fires. Participants get a better view of how matters at various levels get resolved. A 360-degree view of issues certainly helps participants to improve their problem-solving skills. Demerits. The method is somewhat academic and devoid of real-life situations. The participants, knowing fully well that they are handling an imaginary situation, may not be too excited about the whole exercise and may not fully commit themselves to the task. Merits. Management games. Simulations that represent actual business situations are known as business games. These simulations attempt to duplicate selected factors in a specific situation, which are then manipulated by the participants. Business games involve two or more hypothetical organizations competing in a given product market. The participants are assigned such roles as managing director, general manager, and marketing manager. They make decisions affecting price levels, production volume, and inventory levels. The results of their decisions are manipulated by a computer program, with the results simulating those of an actual business situation. Participants are able to see how their decisions affect the other groups and vice versa. Merits. Business games compress time. Events that take painfully long time are made to occur in a matter of hours. One can learn from mistakes, take a different course of action by looking at the consequences, and improve performance. They promote increased understanding of complex relationships among organizational units. They help trainees develop their problem-solving skills as well as to focus attention on planning rather than just putting out fires. Prompt feedback facilitates quick learning. Demerits. It is not easy to develop business games. The cost of developing a good business game might prove to be quite prohibitive in actual practice. They are often far removed from reality. In real life, an executive may get unlimited chances to find his way through the jungle, depending on his mental makeup, instead of choosing from an imaginary list of alternatives. Participants may become so engrossed in pushing others to the wall that they fail to grasp the underlying management principles being taught. Creativity may take a back seat when unorthodox strategies advanced by innovative participants may not find acceptance from others in the race. Conferences and seminars. The conference method is another commonly used method of executive development. Topics such as human relations, safety education, customer relations, sales training, are often discussed, debated, spoken about at conferences specially organized and designed for the purpose. A conference is a meeting of people to discuss a subject of common interest. The conference is structured around a small group meeting wherein a leader helps the group identify and define a problem, guides the discussion along desired lines and summarizes the views that represent the consensus of the group in dealing with the problem. The participants exchange notes, opinions, and ideas on the subject in a systematic and planned way. A conference may be divided into small groups for focused discussions. Participants expected to air their opinions and thoughts freely. In order to ensure its success, participants are expected to come prepared for the conference. The conference leader should conduct the sessions according to a plan, giving enough room for healthy interchange of different viewpoints. The discussion should proceed along desired lines. The size of the group should not be too large. Merits. Participation from small groups ensures its success. There is enough room for cross-fertilization of ideas of exchange of views in an open and transparent manner. Participants can focus on a subject of their choice and examine the issue thoroughly and come out with excellent solutions. Participants can pool their talent and energies together and participate enthusiastically. It is an excellent way of developing conceptual knowledge. Demerits. It is not easy to put participants on a task. Discussions can go in different directions. Putting people on track may prove to be a back-breaking exercise. Conferences often prove to be notorious time wasters. People discuss and debate endlessly without arriving at any consensus. Conferences are often dominated by people who are mic-hungry and seek attention irrespective of whether they have a point to prove or not. A seminar is a form of academic instruction, conducted by a professional organization. People with proven abilities, technical qualifications, and professional expertise often meet in small groups in order to focus on a contemporary subject. It is usually headed by a seminar head whose principal job is to run the discussion along desired lines. The idea behind the seminar method is to familiarize participants with the methodology of their chosen subject and also to allow them to interact with other participants and learn everything about a topic. A seminar can prove to be an intellectually stimulating arena where assigned readings can be discussed, questions can be raised and debates can be conducted. The discussions can be relatively informal, at least compared to the lecture method of academic instructions. Coaching and mentoring. In coaching, the trainee is placed under a particular supervisor who acts as an instructor and teaches job knowledge and skills to the trainee. He tells him what he wants him to do, how it can be done and follows up while it is being done and corrects errors. The act of coaching can be done in several ways. The executive, apart from asking trainees to do the routine work, may ask them to tackle some complex problems by giving them a chance to participate in decision making. For effective coaching, a healthy and open relationship must exist between employees and their supervisors. Many firms conduct formal training courses to improve the coaching skills of their managers. In coaching, participants can learn by actually doing a piece of work and obtain feedback on performance quickly. However, there is no guarantee that supervisors will be able to coach in an effective way. It is easy for the coach to fall short in guiding the learner systematically, even if he knows which systematic experiences are best. Sometimes doing the job on hand may score over learning and watching. Many skills that have an intellectual component are best learned from a book or lecture before coaching could take place. Further, in many cases, the learner cannot develop much beyond the limits of his own boss abilities. Coaching would work well if the coach provides a good model with whom the trainee can identify, if both can be open with each other, if the coach accepts his responsibility fully, and if he provides the trainee with recognition of his improvement and appropriate rewards. Mentoring is a relationship in which a senior manager in an organization assumes the responsibility for grooming a junior person. Technical, interpersonal, and political skills are generally conveyed in such a relationship from the more experienced person. A mentor is a teacher, spouse, counselor, developer of skills and intellect, host, guide, exemplar, and most importantly, supporter and facilitator in the realization of the vision the young person, protege, has about the kind of life he wants as an adult. The main objective of mentoring is to help an employee attain psychological maturity and effectiveness and get integrated with the organization. In a work situation, such mentoring can take place at both formal and informal levels, depending on the prevailing work culture and the commitment from the top management. Formal mentoring can be very fruitful if management invests time and money in such relationship-building exercises. Mentoring can succeed if there is genuine support and commitment from top management. Mentors take up their job seriously and transfer ideas, skills, and experiences in a systematic way. Mentors believe in the whole process and carry out things in an appropriate manner. That's all for this video. Thank you for watching. This video is brought to you by Bookstune. Like this video to encourage us. Share this video to spread the knowledge. And subscribe to this channel for latest update.